Good morning. I feel like I'm whispering because it's one of those sort of sleepy Sunday mornings, isn't it? But goodness, how good to be together. Good to have you here. Whether it's your first time or you've been here many times, you are welcome. A few announcements. First, sign-ups. Wow, it seems like we've had a summer of no sign-ups, but now I'm going to talk about sign-ups as September is upon us. First of all, I noticed that we don't have anyone signed up for coffee, unless something's changed in the last 20 minutes, for September or October going into the fall. If you would like to have coffee and it's a nice time to gather before the service and people stay after, we need people to sign up. So if you could think about that or chat with a friend about sharing that, we'd love to have some coffee and time for fellowship, and we need someone to sign up. The other sign up, I like that. That's like the exclamation point at the end of sign up. We are going to refresh our pictorial directory. Now, people can say what they will about technology. I appreciate our online directory. It allows me, when I'm out and about, to be able to call you without having to carry a big paper directory with me. As you know, on that online directory, your pictures are there. Some of those pictures may be ones that you love, and then we'll just keep them. Some of them may be ones you didn't like to begin with, or you want to update. So your chance is coming on either Saturday, September 24th. So if you want to get ahead of the game and come on a Saturday, 4:15 to 5, that would be before the Saturday service, or Sunday, September 25th, either 8 to 8:45 before the 9 o'clock service or following the service, 10 to 10:45. Heather Roars has graciously agreed to come take pictures. And so if you need to update your picture or need to let us know about any other updates, well, we'd like to do that then. So here's another sign up. You'll also notice that we are having an auction for a quilt. And that sign up for the silent auction is on the welcome table to the side as you leave the narthex on the left. And I put the quilt was not right next to the sign up, so I put it there. And it's a beautiful quilt of lighthouses. It's going to help our church and society raise money for some of the water efforts that we'll be doing over this next few weeks, to help people in places all over the world have access and availability to clean, fresh water. So you'll hear more about that next week on our rally weekend. God's Work Our Hands will be focusing on water with all kinds of activities. But this quilt auction is going to help fund some town, some village's ability to have clean, fresh water. So what do we say, bid high, bid often? Something like that. There's already one bid there, so I expect to see it go up. Now, this is the weekend we bless the quilts. We bless the quilts. We bless the little dresses for Africa that are lovingly hung. And I said I would like to wear one, but I don't think they'll fit me. There are the hats for little heads that have been crocheted or knit. Again, with love, we also have our layettes and our school kits. We're gonna bless them all in just a minute. So I first want to open up the opportunity to you all. If you have an announcement, something that we need to know about, now's the time to make that announcement. Does anyone have an announcement? Raise your hand if you do. All right. I'm going to ask for prayer requests as well before we do our blessing. Prayer requests, I know that Andrea had asked for some prayers for her grandson's significant other, who is facing a pretty serious medical emergency. And so meeting with the doctors and the staff that can help address it, prayers for the wisdom and guidance that will come, and the patience for sometimes what takes a while to resolve medical emergencies. So prayers for that individual. Are there other prayer requests? Well, okay. Let's bless these quilts. I think the number I was given was 107 quilts made. So as you know, that's a wonderful thing. I don't even know if we can count how many hours, how many needles, how many pieces of thread and tie were used, as well for our little dresses and for the yarn that created the hats, for all of the items in our school kits and our layettes for babies and young children. We bless. If you will join me, I will offer a prayer. God, our neighbors around the world are in need of hope. Your spirit is a mighty force. Your whispers of hope bring light into the world. Open our hearts and hands to see your presence in our neighborhoods and across the world. God, we give you thanks for the pieces of fabric, for the thread, for the sewing machines and the items collected for our kits and our layettes, for the yarn used to make little hats. May their presence be a sign of hope. May these gifts wrap our neighbors in unending love. And may these gifts offer dignity and healing. We give thanks for the hands that fashioned hope into a quilt or a dress or a hat, for the layettes and school kits put together, for the hands that collected and sorted, for the hands that continually open wider, so no one feels left out. We ask a blessing on the staff and partners at Lutheran World Relief. May their voices and hands be a beacon of hope. Keep them safe. Keep them filled with strength and perseverance. God, be with our neighbors who receive these gifts. May they be wrapped in love. May they taste your goodness. May they touch signs of your hope. Whether or not we know their names or where they live, they are our neighbors, our brothers and sisters in Christ. We pray all this in the name of Jesus, the one who is our hope. Amen. Well, I now invite you to rise, whether it's in your body or in your spirit, for our call to worship, which has as its heart our mission statement here at St. John. We are gathered in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit to know and proclaim Jesus Christ and as disciples reach out in love. Let us worship the Lord. Dear friends, together let us acknowledge our failure to love this world as Jesus does. God of mercy and forgiveness, we confess that sin still has a hold on us. We have harmed your good creation. We have failed to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with you. Turn us in a new direction. Show us the path that leads to life. Be our refuge and strength on the journey. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and friend. Amen. Beloved of God, your sins are forgiven and you are made whole. God points the way to new life in Christ who meets us on the road. Journey now in God's abiding love through the power of the Spirit. Amen. Our gathering hymn this morning is Lift High the Cross. Either follow on the screens in the red hymnal where it is 660. We'll do verses 1 and 4. the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Direct us, O Lord, in all our doings with your continual help, that in all our works, begun, continued, and ended in you, we may glorify your holy name, and finally, by your mercy, bring us to everlasting life through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. It's time for the morning readings. And Rachel's going to be wonderfully proactive and jump in because our lector who was to be here could not. Thank you, Rachel.
Good morning. Moses speaks to the Israelites who are about to enter the land promised to their ancestors. In this passage, he lays out the stark choice before them. Choose life by loving and obeying the Lord, or choose death by following other gods. A reading from Deuteronomy, the 30th chapter. See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today, by loving the Lord your God, walking in his ways and observing his commandments, decrees and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous. And the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall perish. You shall not live in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him and holding fast to him. for that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read Psalm 1 responsively. Happy are they who have not walked in the counsel of the wicked, nor lingered in the way of sinners, nor sat in the seats of the scornful.
Their delight is in the law of the Lord, and they meditate on God's teaching day and night.
They are like trees planted by streams of water, bearing fruit in due season, with leaves that do not wither. Everything they do shall prosper.
It is not so with the wicked. They are like chaff which the wind blows away.
Therefore the wicked shall not stand upright when judgment comes, nor the sinner in the counsel of the righteous.
For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked shall be destroyed.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Rachel. And I invite you to rise for the gospel. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. Now, large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and he turned and said to them, "Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not first sit down and estimate the cost to see whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he's laid the foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.' Or what king, going out to wage war against another king, will not sit down first and consider whether he is able, with 10,000, to oppose the one who comes against him with 20,000? If he cannot, then, while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for the terms of peace. So therefore, none of you can become my disciple if you do not give up all your possessions." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Well, I invite a blessing on this word. It's a word we must mull on and contemplate and weigh. I pray that it brings us at least great thought. Amen. So, this is the Labor Day weekend, and many people have off Monday. Not everybody, but many do, to think about what work is, or to rest from the work that you've been doing. When I was younger, when I was in high school, I had a teacher assign in English a book by Studs Terkel. I grew up in the suburbs of Chicago, and Studs Terkel was very well known as someone who reported and interviewed people, everyday people, about their everyday life. In this book on working, Duds Terkel interviewed people about, well, the jobs they did. And it was a book that, well, at first I thought it was kind of long. But as I read through these interviews, as I read about the people and their feelings about the work they were doing, several things became clear. Many people offered that they didn't look forward to going to work, that they didn't like their job necessarily. And many of you may feel the same. I hope not, but it may be true. Also, many people valued the idea of work, at least. Even if they didn't like the job they were currently doing, they felt that what work was important. And they wanted, not necessarily even to be equal with everyone in the workplace, but to at least be respected and to work in a safe place. In fact, this Labor Day weekend came into being back in the 1800s when a big group of workers in New York City got together and decided to have a parade, a gathering, to walk in solidarity with one another about work and about what workers could and should expect in a workplace, in a work environment. So how this might relate to our text from Luke, well, I'm going to work at that right now. I think a challenge most congregations I know face, at least my experience has been, is to connect what we do here on the weekend, whether it be Saturday night or Sunday morning, to what we do during the rest of the week, right? You're here for, maybe an hour and a half, and then there's all that other time. How do we connect here to out there? I think it's a challenge, and always has been, for the church. Relevancy, right, to the things we do outside these walls. And while it's my hope that many of you do find the sermons, and I'm not looking for you to tell me that you do or that you don't, but feel free to share anyways, because I'm always open to a good word or even a word for growth, or the scriptures, or even the liturgy. It's my hope that you're able to say, yeah, this applies to me in, but I also know it doesn't always. I think there are people who listen and are a part of the worship service week in and week out, who might not connect, make the leap to what they do, what your labor is, as holy, who maybe do not see an everyday effort as important to God. So not just what you do here, but out in other places, as equally important to God. To imagine, not just here, but elsewhere, that you are God's partner doing God's work in the world. Church leaders, and I honestly will admit to this, well, we haven't done the best job of helping you make that connection. Most churches, and we will be one of them at some point this fall, will set aside a time during the service to recognize our faith formation teachers, those who work with our youngers, those who are with our confirmands. We will install them and honor them. How many pastors, and I can tell you, not one of them, has set aside a Sunday, maybe in early April, to consecrate our accountants for the work they do? How many of us recognize the work of our plumbers and electricians or carpenters? How often do we regularly pray for those who volunteer, not just in church, but in a variety of ways in our community, ways that are depended upon? Maybe we need to rethink nurturing the imagination of everyone to believe that God is at work in you, in me, for the sake of the world God loves so much, in everything we do. If people can't figure out that what is done here needs to matter out there, well, I think we might see our attendance dwindle, won't we? I think that's where this week's gospel reading comes in. Now, people are often concerned, as I am, about this message from Jesus to hate mother and father, brother and sister. I will tell you that the translation from the Greek isn't a direct word that we would say hate. It's more a sense of letting go. How do we let go of those things that we're attached to so that we might be open to the Spirit working through us, even in our place of employment? How might we think about Jesus asking us to take up the cross as something everyday and ordinary instead of some big, big travail? Alan Culpepper, theologian, says, "The language of cross bearing, well, it's been corrupted by overuse. Bearing a cross has nothing to do with a chronic illness or a painful physical condition or even a trying family relationship. It should be instead what we do voluntarily as a consequence of our commitment to Christ. So we are always bearing the cross, and hopefully joyfully. If this is true, then we are invited to take up our cross, that is, have our life shaped by our commitment to the Messiah, the crucified Messiah. Anywhere, anytime, doing just about anything. Voters and volunteers, website managers, temp workers, bus drivers and barbers, students, secretaries, parents, payroll officers. All these people, when they offer their time, talent, and labor to God, are bearing their cross by allowing their lives to be shaped by their commitment to Christ." Think Jesus, in maybe an exaggerated way, is encouraging the disciples and those gathered to think about how they might change how they relate to others by who Jesus is to them and what Jesus asks. How powerful, isn't it, to hear that what you do at home and at work, while volunteering or being a good friend, matters to God. It makes a difference in the world. I hope that you might find it easier and easier to connect faith in daily life and discover a whole new reason to keep coming to church when you're able to say, "I do this because it matters," elsewhere. Amen. So, our hymn of the day. We remain seated for it, but we certainly sing it together. It will be "Let Us Ever Walk with Jesus," 802 in the hymnal. We'll do verses 1 and 4. And again, as I said, we join into the singing together. I invite you to rise as we, with the whole church, confess our faith in the words found in the Apostles' Creed. And of course, I know it by heart, but I'm still going to turn my page. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As scattered grains of wheat are gathered together into one bread, so let us gather our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of God's good creation. We pray for the church around the world and for the mission of the gospel. Refresh the hearts of your people, deepen our understanding of every good thing we share, and strengthen our partnerships in the faith. God of grace, hear our prayer. For the well-being of the earth and all its creatures, for trees and forests, for all that will yield fruit this season, for the streams and other bodies of water. God of grace, hear our prayer. For the nations and those in authority, for the elected leaders of our towns, our states, our country, and for international organizations. Grant wisdom to those who govern. Raise up citizens who make decisions in the best interest of their neighbors. God of grace, hear our prayer. For all in need, for those who suffer from disease, who struggle with homelessness or food insecurity, for those whose family life is difficult, and for all in this community who need your care, especially for Andrea's grandson's significant other as they receive care this week. God of grace, hear our prayer. For this community of faith, for all our labors, begun, continued, and ended in you, that they glorify your holy name. Bless your people with the strength to live into their many vocations for the sake of the world. God of grace, hear our prayer. And as always, in keeping with God's commandment that we pray for others, we pray for those who celebrate their birthday this month. We pray for Kim. We pray for Kay. We pray for Emma. We pray for the mission and ministry of St. John Lutheran Church in Boscobel, Wisconsin. We remember Sue as well. We keep those who are currently receiving medical interventions or receiving medical care in our prayers. We also now, Lord, fill this place with the prayers of our hearts. They may be unspoken, but they are always heard. God of grace, hear our prayer. We give thanks for the saints who now rest from their labors. Give us faith like them to love you with all our hearts. And by your mercy, bring us to everlasting life. God of grace, hear our prayer. Gathered together in this sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, gracious God, we offer these and all our prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. You may give to your neighbor a friendly sign of peace, a high five, a peace sign, and then we will sit and take our morning offering. To rise as we sing our thanks. God of all creation, all you have made is good. Your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it. Gave it to all his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us now pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Christ invites you to this table. Come, taste, and see. You may be seated. Here at St. John, this is an open communion table, and all are welcome to come to it. We receive communion side by side. We'll start with this side. Ushers will indicate when you come forward. I will have a wafer, and if you need a gluten-free alternative, guess what? I have that too. You'll take, you'll eat, and then Rachel will have the tray of cups. Some of the cups have a darker colored wine. Some have a lighter colored juice. Indicate which you prefer. Take, drink, and then on your way back to your seats, you can place your cups in the little baskets. Come, for all is ready.
Thank you.
Please rise. And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. God of the abundant table, you've refreshed our hearts in this meal with bread for the journey. Give us your grace on the road that we might serve our neighbors with joy for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And a blessing for your journey, God who gives life to all things and frees us from despair, bless you with truth and peace. And may the Holy Trinity, one God, guide you always in faith, hope, and love. Amen. Our sending hymn this morning is 733, Great is Thy Faithfulness. We're going to sing all three, I think it's three verses, so we'll sing out loud with joy. Go in peace with Christ beside you. Thanks be to God.